ahead and open up this Thursday, August 20th, meeting of the Zoning Board of Appeals. First case we have on the agenda tonight is case number 15-07. Applicant is here. Okay. Let me go ahead and read the legal notice, and we'll go from there. Okay. The Zoning Board of Appeals will hold a public hearing in the Selectmen's Meeting Room at Town Hall, 16 Lowell Street, Reading, Massachusetts, on Thursday, August 20th, 2015, at 7 p.m. on the petition of Janet Forbes Scott and Kevin Scott, who seek a special permit under Section 7.3.2 of the zoning bylaws in order to construct a front porch 18 feet by 6 feet with a right sideline setback, it's supposed to be, of 14.6 feet rather than the 15-foot required side yard on the property located at 52 Pearl Street in Reading, Massachusetts. Unless there is an objection, I will dispense with the reading of the abutters list, except to say that the abutters were notified, as were the following: Board of Selectmen, Police Department, Building Department, Health Department, Engineering Division, members and associate members of the Board of Appeals, Town Clerk, Fire Department, Conservation Commission, Assessor's Office, and CPDC, as well as the planning boards of Wakefield, Linfield, North Reading, Stoneham, Woburn, and Wilmington. Testimony given before this board is taken under oath. So if you think you may want to speak tonight, please stand and raise your right hand. I swear that the testimony given by me before this board will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. Responses, I do.
I do.
Okay, thank you. If you'd like to give us your presentation. Thank you.
I'm the architect for the project, and I apologize. I'm suffering from a little bit of laryngitis, so it has to be tonight. This is a very old, turn of the century farmhouse that probably had a porch on it. We don't know, but we want to add back a porch. And it is non-conforming, quite non-conforming to the side, as are pretty much most of the properties in that neighborhood. Our goal is to add this porch off the front. And in order to miss the molding around the front door, we needed to extend it a little bit further than just to the 15 feet. So we came up with 14.6 as the boundary. We think that because the neighborhood has a lot of farmers' porches, this is the farm-style house, that it would be very appropriate for the neighborhood and not at all a detriment. And as I said, it's really not getting too much closer. The rest of the house is as close as 7.4, I believe, in the closest point to the side. So we ask your consideration, and if you have any questions, please feel free to ask.
Okay, thank you. Before we get into it, I know we did receive, or I did, and I don't know, I think he emailed it, and everybody maybe got it in their emails from Glenn. He noted he had looked at this. And he says, this proposal is to add a 6-by-18-foot farmer's porch, which is located in the front yard 14.6 feet from the right side property line. Since the existing right side setback is 7.4 feet, this proposal is allowed if a special permit is obtained under Section 7.3.2. And Glenn went on to say, I do not have any objections to this request. That's from Mr. Redman. David. Any comments on this? Would you like to say
No, I mean, it seems pretty straightforward. Just elaborate a little bit on why you felt like the design needed to encroach into the side yard setback.
The front door is to the right, and it has molding and trim around it. And as we did some studies, obviously the contractor would like us not to have gone for a special permit, but we did some studies to try and keep it within the 15 feet. And it just crowded that molding so much. So when you have this beautiful porch that you're putting on, it seems silly to have to compromise that molding that's going to be around that front door. So that's truly the intent, was to try and make sure that it fit the house was the right proportions and scale, and it didn't encroach into that trim molding and make it look as if it's just hacked on.
Okay. That's the only question I had.
Okay. Catherine?
I really don't. I have no questions.
No. Nothing? John? Any questions?
Just one. You also are going to add an addition to the rear of the home.
That was already added. That's completed and was done how many years ago?
4 years
ago. 4 years ago. So this is just the next phase. They already have the garage. They already have the addition at the back. This is just the front porch.
Gotcha.
That's it.
No, I mean, I kept looking at it, and I'm trying to figure out what the addition that your plan didn't have on the back, and it appeared to be there already, so I was confused about that a little bit. No, I understand what the building inspector was requesting of us. The new bylaws are a little bit different than the old bylaws, and consequently, you could have come in for both or not come in for either one, depending upon how the building inspector rules. So my question was, did you really need to come in for this evening? And the building inspector has the option of saying, I'm not sure, so come before the board, so that's why you're here. Okay.
This change, but yeah.
Okay, then I have no questions other than that.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you, John. Si?
I would agree with everyone else. It's very straightforward, and I took a ride through there today, and it looked like the vast majority of the houses in that area already have what you're putting on.
Exactly.
So it's going to look like all the others.
That's exactly right.
So I don't have a problem with it.
Yeah. And, okay, in the short of it, I don't have an issue with it either. Going through it, just wrote some notes down, looking at the real estate sheet on it. It looks like it's about circa 1880 or so house. As you say, there was the farmhouse maybe in the area. Certainly predates zoning. It's considered a legal non-conforming lot, I would say then, even though it has less than the required frontage and less of the required area for a lot in that zone. And the dwelling itself is considered non-conforming in that the existing setbacks do not conform to current requirements. But again, that's the existing house, and the proposed front porch certainly is not going to make the setbacks or increase the non-conformity at all. So we'll note that. And that's what I noted. The front porch is it looked like it was aligned with the front door that way. And certainly it's less than even the front of the house. The corner, yeah, the front corner of the house is 12.8 according to the plan. And the actual front corner of the porch is 14.6. So it's, 1.8 feet.
Correct.
Kicked in from the front of the house. So I certainly don't have an issue with that. I'll open this up to public comments. Is there anybody here from the public who would like to comment on this?
Can we have a name and address? Elise Sarnia, 48 Pearl Street.
Okay.
Jane's been my neighbor for 23 years. My house is actually on the Reading, the historical register, because it is a circa 1890 house, and we did all the colors, and we try to keep it authentic. And I would be thrilled if Jan's house had a porch that, made it look like it used to, most likely. And that it would actually conform to the houses that are in the neighborhood that date from that period with the farmer's porch. It would be a wonderful addition, I think. And I know Nancy would do a great job.
Okay, thank you. Are there any other comments from the public? If not, I'll close the public portion of this hearing, and I would entertain a motion at this time, I guess, from a board member in regards to this case.
I'll make a motion.
Well, okay, David.
I move that the ZBA approve the petition of Janet Forbes Scott and Kevin Scott and grant a special permit under section 732 of the Reading zoning bylaw in order to allow them to construct the front porch 18 feet by 6 feet with a right side setback of 14.6 feet rather than the required 15 feet side yard setback on the property located at 52 Pearl Street in Reading, Massachusetts, with the usual three conditions.
Okay.
Do you want to reference the plan?
We'll reference the plan as well with the also the usual three conditions.
In other words, that's getting your occupancy permits, your building permits, foundation permits.
Referencing also plan stamped appears to be July 29, 2015 by, and I'm going to butcher his name, Stephen
Melischuk. Check.
I'll take your word for it. Professional land surveyor of 23 Foster's Lane, Wakefield, Mass. Do we want to also reference the elevation or architecturals as well?
I think we usually do. It does show the...
Yeah, I suppose we should.
It shows the farmer's porch and, you know, in regards to... It's not, you know, in general conformity with the architectural plan submitted.
As well as the Toomey design drawings, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 sheets, numbered sheets 1 of 5 through 5 of 5. Undated.
Dated 7/26/15.
Oh, yeah.
July 26.
Oh, 7/26/15.
Yep.
Boy.
Yep.
I didn't know if I needed to put my glasses on or off. 7/26/15. So moved.
Second.
We have a motion, a second. Is there any further comments? No further comments. All those in favor of the motion, raise your hand. Thank you. Let the record show is 5-4, 0 against, and 0 abstaining. Thank you.
Thank you.
We have, I don't think it's changed. 14 days, we'll write up the decision. We'll submit that with the town clerk.
Excellent.
And then from there, it has to be recorded at the registry.
Very good. Thank you.
Oh, okay. And let me stamp some plans for you, too, Nancy.
Great. Thank you very much.
Yeah, well, you'll have a record of that.
Very
good. Okay, thank you. Just write the, take care of the case file. Okay, I'll be right with you all on the next case. be patient. And ready for case number 1506. The applicant's here. I say okay. Let me go ahead and read the legal notice, and we will go from there. The Zoning Board of Appeals will hold a public hearing in the Selectmen's Meeting Room at the Town Hall, 16 Lowell Street, Reading, Massachusetts, on Thursday, August 6, 2015, at 7 p.m. on the petition of Jack Sullivan, who seeks a variance under Section 6.2.1b, lot shape, of the zoning bylaw in order to subdivide the property into two lots, one buildable and one non-buildable, on the property located at 116 Van Norden Road in Reading, Massachusetts. This lot is located in the S20 district. Unless there is an objection, I will dispense with the reading of the abutters list, except to say that the abutters were notified, as were the following: Board of Selectmen, Police Department, Building Department, Health Department, Engineering Division, members and associate members of the Board of Appeals, Town Clerk, Fire Department, Conservation Commission, Assessor's Office, and CPDC, as well as the planning boards of Wakefield, North Reading, Woburn, Linfield, Stoneham, and Wilmington. Testimony given before this board is taken under oath. So if you think you may want to speak tonight, please stand, raise your right hand, and I will swear you in. Okay, and if there are any abutters that think they may want to speak tonight, also I can give you the oath. Okay, I swear the testimony given by me before this board will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. Responses, I do.
I do.
Okay, thank you, Jack.
Yeah.
This is a continuation from August.
No, it's a new hearing.
It's a new hearing, right. Oh.
We haven't been in front of this.
No, but it was scheduled and we didn't have a full board.
That's correct.
And so a postponement of the opening.
Correct.
Then took into effect. Okay, Jack. I think we've had a flurry of emails today going back and forth and correspondence in regards to the ownership of this parcel. I think maybe you might want to touch upon that. Okay?
Okay,
we'll,
sure.
We'll give you the floor right now.
I know Town Council weighed in on this as well. So
yeah.
Fred Bonney is the applicant. He was the owner, but yesterday I got a call from from Chuck Tyrone, who's the conservation administrator, saying that there's an issue. The town actually took this property for tax title on a tax lien about a year ago. I said, they asked if I was aware of this. I said, no, I'm not a title attorney. I was unaware. The assessor still had Fred as the owner. But as such, Gene Delios and town staff got together, the town manager got together, town council weighed in that it appears the town's the owner of this property. I don't have proof one way or the other, but
okay.
I did get an email late this afternoon saying that they would look for the ZBA to open this hearing, close it, and then deny the project.
A couple of scenarios what we could do on this.
Right.
Number one, I think, okay, we know what's happening. I think the board members maybe, you know, we'll go around and get their comments, and I think we'll come up with a consensus from the board here of what we'll do. And there's certainly the options that we do not have to do what you just said. Open it, close it, and deny it. I mean, it can be withdrawn without prejudice, I believe. I believe it could be continued if somebody wanted to further research and come up with who the actual and attested, you know, it would have to be an attested ownership deed or something to that effect, I would think. Maybe not. Okay. Well, we have a couple of attorneys here who can certainly comment on that.
I like option B or C. And the only, Even if it was withdrawn without prejudice, that would allow that Fred resolves his issues.
Once it's resolved.
Takes care of things. My concern when I got the option A.
Right.
Is then if we come back with the same application, which we probably would, then technically, you know, does that fall in the 2-year moratorium where we're not allowed to reapply? I didn't know, even though I'd be allowed to speak tonight, or I would have dressed up.
It's kind of a funny area here on it, because technically you're representing the owner, and you know, we don't know who the owner is, so
right.
It's
right.
Like, should we let you speak? But I don't have an issue with it. But why don't we go to the board members?
Okay,
David,
thanks.
I know you've been involved with this back and forth today quite a bit. Maybe you would want to come up with
I think make it clear for the record that it's that we've been informed that it is the town's position that the town owns this land and not
mm-hmm.
the applicant or the applicant that you represent.
As
such, that creates an issue of standing, and therefore your application is void.
Right.
Because if the town is correct that the town is the owner via tax taking, you have no authorization to be a petitioner on behalf of any application for this property.
Correct.
So that having that on the record, I think is important. Until that matter's cleared up, you have no standing to petition the board for anything. Now, I don't think there is any way that we could continue, again, my opinion,
yep.
That we could continue this petition, because the petition technically is not a petition. You don't have any standing at all, if the town's right.
Correct.
A withdrawal without prejudice, while it perhaps preserves your right to come back and impacts the moratorium issue, again, that presumes that the applicant has standing to petition us for
right.
any relief.
Yeah.
So unfortunately, again, my opinion, the rest of the board members haven't weighed in, that unfortunately I think from a regulation standpoint, regulatory standpoint, legal standpoint, our only option is we've given the applicant an opportunity to be heard on the issue of ownership and standing, and where it's still unclear, or we don't have anything to dispute the town's assertion that they've taken the property for non-payment of taxes, that our only option is to vote on the petition and deny it for lack of standing.
Mm-hmm.
It still gives the applicant a right to appeal that decision.
Absolutely.
And I think, and again, that's my position, as draconian as it might sound.
Mm-hmm. Okay, question, David, and maybe as an attorney you could clarify this in my mind anyway. If they have no standing, if the applicant has no standing with this application now because they do not own the property, we go through the process of opening, closing the meeting, motioning, and denying it because they have no standing. It's almost like they didn't submit a petition then. And to me, it would be, once this is cleared up, they could come back then with a new petition if they are the owners, if in fact it's proven. Is that true?
Well,
maybe it's.
Once the board issues a decision, and that decision is part of the public record, that implicates the statute and the timing, the moratorium and the timing. So once this board votes, unfortunately, unless the applicant chooses to pursue an avenue of appeal of our board's decision, they're precluded.
You don't think that, you think that's the end?
I think that's the end of it.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Unfortunately.
Okay. Kathleen?
You made the observation in your commentary that you felt that, by the fact that the town says it's theirs,
correct, that the...
It didn't exist.
Correct, without getting into a long winded...
If that were the case, then why would we even vote?
We would have to vote on it to have a disposition on the board's feeling relating to standing. Otherwise, perhaps there would be an argument that without voting on it, the board tacitly approved the application. Case law is weird on that subject, but essentially that's where it comes down, is if we don't vote on it and don't deny it, there's an argument that perhaps the board approved it. Whether that argument carries the day or whether or not it's ever made is a different story, but I think we have to close that door, if you will.
And if the board denied it based on ownership, and that we were seeking lot shape, and I know when you come back in, you have to come in with something different. We'd be coming in, if Fred resolves this with the town, which it sounds like there's some avenues to do that. And then we came in with the same application. We really never got into the discussion of lot shape, because technically you don't have a legal petition in front of you. You're basically denying this because whoever signed this as the owner isn't technically the owner. If the town is the owner, then we didn't even really get into the merits of the case. That's what I was wondering. If this gets denied, and we didn't get into any of the reasons for this variance request, if we could come back with that same variance, if Fred then somehow gains back his ownership rights into this property. I know it's complicated.
It is complicated. It's also complicated in that while I am an attorney, I'm not your and your client's attorney.
Right.
I'm not the board's attorney or the town's attorney.
You're not town council either.
I've given my two cents, my opinion as a member of the board, having some experience in the area as an attorney, but I don't think I feel comfortable answering that question.
That's understandable. I think the option you laid out, and Fred would maybe have to get an attorney, is if the board denies it, then his position is to appeal it, get an attorney, talk to the town, and then see how we resolve this. I understand your position as a board on this.
Kathleen, do you have any additional comments?
I see where you're coming. Withdrawal, that would be the best case for you, but without standing, I don't know if that's something we can act on, and I think standing is the real issue. But I understand coming back in 2 years isn't something that would be necessarily the best, best for you as well. So, but I also think we also have to go by with the advice that we've been given by the town council. So I think our hands are somewhat tied. So I don't have a lot to add to what David said.
John, anything you'd like to add to this?
A couple of things. The advice from town council is that we give the applicant or the individual signed as the applicant an option to withdraw at the time the hearing was opened. The way I look at this is we are sitting here, we are in a hearing, we've opened the hearing, the town has accepted the fact that there is a petition requested. You paid money to the town for that request for a hearing. Because of the lateness of who owns whatever, which is the complication here, I think that there is a mistake probably on both parties. I think the easiest, and I'm not an attorney, as the other two members are, but I am concerned that the fact that we are sitting here, there was a hearing scheduled, it was advertised for a 3-week period, we're into that process, so we need to do something. And I think the town council had made mention of the fact that if there was nobody present to withdraw, option two was to open the hearing and close it and vote the request down So I'm of the opinion that it is better at this point to allow the applicant, or what was on the application as the applicant, to withdraw without prejudice and allow the process to move forward to whatever extent is possible, because there's no harm, no foul at this point. If we turn it down, there is a two-year moratorium. If you come in with the same thing, you have to go through the courts to appeal it, through two other boards or one other board besides us to get back here again, all because of the tardiness of what we've gone through. So I'm of the opinion that it would be best to allow the applicant to withdraw without prejudice.
Okay. Si? I would tend to lean in the direction of John. What bothers me a little bit here is that this application has been on the books quite a while. It didn't show up yesterday. And I'm just a little surprised that all of this comes to the forefront the day or two before this meeting takes place. That bothers me a lot. This should have come up long before today. But we're stuck with the fact that there is a dispute or a difference of opinion on the ownership of the property. The town feels that it is theirs. I think we have no choice but to go along with that, obviously. But I would agree with John that the town council said the best course of action would be to allow a withdrawal if the petitioner so chose to do so, as opposed to taking the vote. So I would tend to side with Mr. DeRima's opinion.
Mm-hmm. Well, as we haven't gotten into the merits of the case,
yeah,
merits of the application, perhaps withdrawal is appropriate because we haven't touched on it. We haven't presented an application.
Maybe this is, I assume this was the last one that I got from town council, an email that I printed out. And his last recommendation I got was, accordingly, I recommend the ZBA proceed as follows. One, open the public hearing. We've done that. Two, have the chair explain the town's belief that the applicant does not actually own the property. And I think the board has done that. And three, give the applicant an opportunity to address that specific issue. You've let him have a chance to speak. And then he goes on to say, depending upon the answers, the ZBA could then move forward to close the hearing and deny the application in the same breath. I think, and I know he also did note the cleanest might be to withdraw without prejudice. I think either way, if it were open and then denied, not because of the actual premise of what they wanted to do, but because the application was incorrect, they would have to come back with a whole new application, new advertisement, new case number, et cetera, et cetera. And the same thing they were going to have to do with, I think, if they withdraw without prejudice and they wanted to come back. But they not. They would be assigned a new case number and a whole new process would be started again.
We're walking a fine line, in my opinion, because, again, technically, practice dictates that the applicant shouldn't have let us open the public meeting and should have, when presented with the applicant, the appropriate time, should have immediately risen.
You're thinking it should have withdrawn.
Again, maybe I'm splitting hairs because by opening the public hearing, you're giving the applicant notice of their right to be heard. So, again, that may be splitting hairs. So, I don't think we're. It's a fine line.
Yeah.
And I guess we just need to decide which way we want to step over it.
I wouldn't be opposed if there was a withdrawal without prejudice. And I think we've heard everybody from the board members. I will. Go back to the applicant, and maybe you want to discuss it with your clients a bit, or would you want to? How you want to proceed? But
we discussed it. I mean, we would like to withdraw. We'd like to request from the board
that is your preference
without without prejudice.
Okay.
And the only reason I didn't stand up and ask immediately that is because when I got the emails, it said it was going to open, close, and be denied.
Yes.
I didn't even think I'd have a chance to speak because I don't even have a
legal
petition.
That's the way I read it, too.
So that, I was here more just to hear the board deny us tonight than even be allowed to speak, to be honest with everybody.
That's exactly the way I read it. If you read the emails, it was like, well, you have to open it, and then you have to formally close it, and then you have to go through that.
But I'm hoping Mr. Bonney can resolve his issues with the town, and then we come back in and try it again. So if you're open to voting on the withdrawal without prejudice, that would be our preference.
Okay. We have a request from the applicant before the board to withdraw without prejudice. I guess I would entertain a motion then from the board member on that.
So moved then.
So moved, John. You're making the motion that to the board allow the applicant to withdraw without prejudice his application for case number 15-06.
With the understanding that there is a question of standing here, and the board felt, if the board feels, the board felt that this was the easiest way to resolve the issue at this point in time.
Yeah. I think it is. Personally, myself, I think it's a clean way to do it.
I'll second that comment, too.
So we have a motion. We have a second, I believe. You second the motion.
Yes,
John,
I did.
Sigh.
Yeah.
Any further comment? Okay, all those in favor of the applicant's request to withdraw without prejudice, raise your hand. All those opposed? Let the record show, approved by the board, 4-1-0. With Mr. Trainello voting no. Thank you. So. And we'll write that up, and it'll be in the town in the files with the town clerk. Yeah, I don't believe that it has to be registered to register or anything.
No.
But it'll be on
it'll,
file.
It'll be
we'll
there
have
when
to
you
write
get
something
back to the
up.
File.
Yeah.
Okay.
We'll have to write something.
Thank you very much.
Okay.
Thank you.
A confusing situation.
Okay.
Have a nice night.
Okay. John, you made that motion. Can you write up a couple of paragraphs on that? I appreciate it. Yeah, I don't think we need to do it too much more. Withdraw without prejudice. Yeah, very sure. Yeah. Yeah.
I
Next item on the agenda for this, for the case tonight, for complete. Right. No, we have other business, right. Other business. And under other business, we have a, I guess the best word is a presentation by the Historical Commission in regards to a property on Lowell Street that they would like to discuss with the board of, on that. And I will note to the board that it was approximately 2 weeks ago, 3 weeks ago, I met with the, with just two members of the Historical Commission here at Town Hall. They were asking the process in regards to if they wanted to develop ahead of house, a property, and they wanted to save that property, and yet they might need some zoning board work, how would they go about it? And I suggested at that time that maybe that they could come in under other business and discuss it with the board, and the board could maybe give them a direction at that point on that. So I just wanted to point that out to the board that I had sat down one day for a 45-minute meeting or so with them. In the town planner, too, was there, Jesse Wilson, yeah. Okay, from the Historical Commission, whoever would like to make the presentation?
I believe the developer would like to.
Okay.
And then we'll follow up.
Hi, my name's Dave Johnson. I'm the owner of 116 Lowell Street, and I'm here with, as you know, members of the Historical Commission. My intent for this property was to tear down the house, subdivide it to two lots via the A&R. It makes all the requirements for an A&R. It's just under an acre. Two S15 lots with two three-bedroom homes on it. Being built in 1816 and on the town's list, it went for the historical demolition delay, which was voted in. Mm-hmm. And according to your bylaw, as the owner, I'm required to, you know, give access to the property and work with the commission to see if there's a resolution that, you know, make everybody happy. After about a couple and a half, 3 months of trying to find other contractors, reclamation companies, contacting historic clubs, see if there was anybody that might be interested in moving the house, moving the components of the house, moving the house in sections, or anything like that, we hit a lot of dead ends. And finally, we somebody, I think it might have been Jonathan, I can't actually remember, came mentioned, well, if this was an eight-room house, can't you by right make it a two-family, two condos, and then do that on one lot, and then do the a house on the other? And why came back to them and said I really wasn't interested in renovating the house from the get-go because it's in such poor condition. But I would if the logic being if by right I could turn that into a two-family and sell two condos, then maybe we could go to the ZBA and ask them if I could, on one of the lots, build a brand new two-unit, and then I'd renovate that as a single. For many reasons, it's a money loser trying to turn that into a two-family. It's only 20 feet deep. I mean, I could go on and on about the structure and all that, but what I told them was I'd be interested if the ZBA were to say you can build a brand new two on one lot and renovate that on the other. And I says, well, okay. The first hurdle would be to have our building inspector, Mr. Glenn Redman, out to the property. Glenn met us on July 13th, met me in Virginia, and we were pretty sure on the rule. I said, I believe there was a certain date associated, 1940-something. So he came out, he said he wasn't sure if it should have been, had to be part of the original building, but he did agree that there was eight rooms, but did not agree that one of the rooms was definitely not original and that it was built, he did not agree that it was built by 1942. He invited me to come into the office, which I did the subsequent Wednesday, and we went over the bylaw, and sure enough, it's April of 42. It needs to be part of the building prior to that. In order to be counted as one of the eight habitable rooms. Glenn, very straight shooter, flat out told me, he says, no way, was that before April 42 in his opinion, but I was more than welcome to go and prove it. And if I could prove to him that that was there before April of 42, he could change his tune. So from there, I came right upstairs to the assessor's office. Their records go back to 68, as you guys probably know. And they said, well, the archives of all the assessor's maps are in the hands of the Historical Commission. So I kind of went full circle pretty quick. And at the next meeting, I let them know that and said, well, this is where we're at. We don't have eight habitable rooms prior to April of 42 until we prove it. And that's where now I would defer to them, and because they believe they can make arguments to you, and we're seeking an opinion from you as to, A, whether or not you would buy into the eight rooms prior to April of 42, I guess, is that right? And then whether or not you would allow a brand new two on one lot and the renovation on the other. The house would have to be moved onto off the foundation and moved onto another foundation on the other lot. Yeah.
I know. Again, I think now, when we didn't talk specifics, I didn't know where the property was or anything when I sat down with Jonathan and Virginia at that meeting in Jesse. And I think that's exactly what I had noted then. Usually when we run into cases like this, and we have before, with people trying to convert a dwelling into a two-family or more, and they say, well, you know, years ago it was this, or there were so many people. I said, the board would want documentation, proof, like Glenn does. Right. And you would want proof, written proof, that, you know, there were those number of rooms there or whatever. Now, I didn't know the lot was, this is the first I've heard tonight, in regards to the lot being subdivided, and it will be an A&R, you noticed?
Yes.
Yes, which is authorization or signature is not required by CPDC on that to subdivide that lot. So you would have, so, you know, if you, to me, there, if you have sufficient frontage, sufficient area, to create two lots, I don't know what you would need from us. I'm assuming you would build a new structure on a vacant lot that you're creating, and it would meet all zoning setbacks.
That's correct. But what the question, well, the first question would have been, if by right I could turn the 1816 house into a two-family and sell it as two condos, which, mm-hmm. you know, would you consider, as long as it's going to wind up as two condos and a house, would you allow the two condos to be a brand new building and just renovate the old, the 1816 house as a single? That's
so
the question. That's the first question. The first hurdle we had to get over before we entertain that was, are there eight habitable rooms prior to April of 42? And Glenn says, no, until you prove it. And that's where the folks from RHC would like to talk to you, I believe, and see if they can get your opinion on at least that before you. And then there's another big question after that.
Okay, any board members would like to ask a question here?
What you're really asking for is originally you wanted to tear down the house that's there or move it and create three individual dwelling units.
I believe.
Just my original proposal was to tear down the 1816 house, subdivide the lot to two lots, and just build two three-bedroom dwellings. That was my original proposal.
Okay.
So the status of the two. Of course, we don't have anything in front of us, so it's very difficult to shoot in the dark.
I think we're just talking generalities here, so it sounds like
Virginia has something that she would like to.
If I may present some information, and all, I'd like to introduce the Historical Commission members that are here, and one of them is going to have to call a meeting to order because we have a quorum. And although we're just informational, we probably won't make any decisions tonight. But as one of those associate members, as is Jack Williams, We are not yet sworn in because all associates are still in limbo until the AG passes the town bylaw. So if you think this is going to be confusing, So Charlene Reynolds is a former chair. She'll probably call the meeting to order.
Yes.
Sally Hilkendorf List is here as a member, and Jonathan Bonds will be presenting tonight. He's a new member as well. So if I may.
And I would like to call the Reading Historical Commission meeting to start. To order.
So this is the property at 116 Lowell Street. It's called the Emery Bancroft House. It has quite a bit of significance because the Bancrofts were very prominent within the town of Reading. And you notice that this property is on the corner of Bancroft Ave, which was named after the Bancroft families. So the old pictures show that it's a five-bay house with two chimneys, and there was a little garage behind it. Presently, we have the plot plan, and it shows the structure with an attached garage. It shows a slight addition because this early part of the house is only one room deep, which is fairly unusual, but not that unusual that it wouldn't have appeared this way. So then there's an addition off here, and then there's another addition here, and a porch and some infill. So the question is, when was this addition added to the house? It is not on the same foundation as the granite foundation as the other house. The lot is quite a good size, and the developer is sure and approved that this can easily be divided into two lots, and with moving the house, because it is a non-conforming house, it's too close to the whole street at right now. So the assessor's records do show that it's an eight-room house, that one of the rooms is was occupied in the attic. Now, we have to give true confessions here. The Historical Commission does maintain the list, cards that the assessor's office used to use, but lo and behold, we have several on Lowell Street. We do not have 116 Lowell Street. We don't have a card for it. We don't have cards for the whole town, and wouldn't you know, it would be great if we had it, but we don't. So Jonathan is going to explain some of the things that we have found in doing this process, because under the demolition delay bylaw, it is the responsibility of the developer and the commission to work together to find alternatives to the demolition. And this developer has really been very cooperative and gone out of his way in trying to secure house movers and different options. And so we're hopeful that we're going to be able to save this early house and by reconfiguring and with your help. Okay, thank you.
Good evening. I'm Jonathan Barnes. Is it okay for me to speak from here, or do you want me someplace else? Okay, thank you. I guess a couple of things, and this is a kind of unusual situation and a fairly complicated situation. And to clarify, and I don't mean to try to make it too simplistic, but the reason we are all here with Dave Johnson as the developer and the owner on this informal basis as a part of your other business, as has been referenced by both Dave and Virginia, we on the Historical Commission have been working very hard and very closely with the developer to try to save this historical house on the inventory. And he has, although his initial idea was to demolish it, as you now know, and put in two new homes on two buildable lots on this property, he has graciously been willing to consider alternatives, and that's what has brought us here. Because in order to obtain in order to go forward with those alternatives, as Dave has indicated, he is going to need, and I guess we would as well, as the Historical Commission trying to save his house on the inventory, he's going to need ZBA approval with respect to two important matters. And that's the, I guess, the frame of reference for our discussion tonight. And he wanted to get a sense before he invests any more than he already has in this particular option, which was not his first option. We wanted to get a sense whether or not this had, as they say, any viability in terms of the ZBA approval going forward. So that's why we wanted to have this discussion as a part of your formal process tonight as other business. The frame of reference for this discussion, as you, I'm sure, have already figured out, is your decision on 172 Washington Street, which was a case back in April or May of 2013. It involved a single-family home on a lot on Washington Street, 172 Washington Street. The developer, it was prior to 1942, and it had the 8 rooms, and it did have, as a matter of right, the ability to convert to 2-family. The developer, unrelated to anybody here, the developer wanted to demolish that house and came before you for a variance, I believe also for a special permit, but what was approved was a variance based on the fact that the original home met the requirements to convert to 2-family, and that based on the 4 parameters for a variance, he or she or they met those parameters to enable you to vote, I think it was 5-0, but I'm not sure, to vote in favor of granting the variance and allow that original home to be demolished and for that developer then to put up a new 2-family home based on the original right of the original home to convert the 2-family. That's the argument that we were contemplating and discussing, and that's why it needs your approval. As Dave has already indicated, it isn't exactly like that case at 172, but that's the frame of reference. The difference is this at least this one issue, and there are 2 important issues, but the first issue is this issue of whether or not it has the 8 rooms. And as you can already see and sense, there is some disagreement about that. And we recognize that, and that's why we were looking for your direction. Clearly in the meetings with the building inspector, he did indicate that he was not convinced that it had been proven that 8th room was there prior to 1942, and he told Mr. Johnson that he required the proof. That would be great if we could get it, but unfortunately, as we've discovered, the records that would confirm whether or not that house had 8 rooms prior to April of 1942 do not exist. So, and as you've already heard, it is not on the original foundation, which is approximately 200 years old. So that in and of itself doesn't prove anything. The one room L, which it does contain this so-called 8th room, was added to the original home because it doesn't have the original granite foundation. We know that. But the date of origin of that L, which would be so nice if we could prove it either way, the date of origin is not conclusive, and that's what we wanted to submit for your consideration and for your discussion, because there are a couple of things that are fact that weigh on this, and we want to argue that those facts should convince you to support the finding that the 8 rooms did exist or did likely exist. There's no documentation to prove that it did exist, but there's also no documentation to conclusively prove that it didn't exist prior to 1942. There are 2 facts that we're aware of. One, we would submit, shows, in our opinion, that it likely did exist prior to 1942. And that is that in looking through the building records for permits for that property, what we have found, and I believe it was Virginia, maybe Carl Midnight as well, but from the Historical Commission, but what we found with respect to that property is since 1942, there has not been a permit submitted to construct the L. Rather, there have been at least four other permits that have been submitted and have been approved for that property after April of 1942. One was to construct a one-car garage, one was to construct a new roof, one was to provide a new gas fitting, another was for a new roof replacement and a new water heater. So we would argue to you that that fact that there has been no permit after 1942 to construct this L, whereas there have been at least four other permits to construct other elements on that property since 1942, that ought to suggest you to find that it did exist prior to 1942. Again, in the spirit of true confessions, there is another fact which contradicts this, to be honest. There is a plot plan which we have seen, which I think Dave has also, I know Dave has seen it, he has it as well. That plot plan for that property, which is dated in February of 1946, does not show the L on it. So that's two contravening pieces of information. The fact that there's a plot plan for that property dated 1946, for which that L is not located, could likely suggest that the L didn't exist at that time. And we recognize that. However, we would submit that the fact that building department records since April of 1942 show at least four permits being requested, none of which is for the L. There was never, after 1942, a permit requested. In the face of the fact that four other permits have been requested, we would argue that belies the plot plan. And there is, in essence, there's contradictory information. So we recognize, and this is the first important element that we're interested in the ZBA's opinion on, before Mr. Johnson decides whether or not he would be willing to continue this process. But we would argue that to reconcile that ambiguity, in light of all of these overall all facts, and I would also submit, in light of the stated purpose in the zoning bylaw in section 1.1, which should guide all of us, including the ZBA, among other purposes for the zoning bylaw. One is to preserve historic structures. So keeping that in mind, we would submit that the way to reconcile these two ambiguous facts, and in the absence of conclusive proof whether it did or did not exist, we would simply argue that where no facts can conclusively confirm that it was added afterwards, it's as likely as not that it was there beforehand, and that therefore this property is entitled to convert to two-family. That's the first element that is important in the mind of the developer to decide whether or not he is going to be inclined to go forward. There's one other point that I think is also important for your consideration that is valuable to him and also valuable to us, and that is this question similar to 172 Washington Street. If you get past the first hurdle, that the house is eligible to convert to two-family, would you be inclined, in light of the facts that could be presented for a variance, to allow this developer the variance, to utilize that right to convert that original historic home to two-family, and place it on one buildable lot on this property and allow him to build, as he did in 172 Washington Street, a new two-family home? And to assist that, and this will be my last, I guess, argument or information for you. Again, assuming that you find that the house is eligible, the original house is eligible because it has the eight rooms, the variance would be based on, I guess, the following arguments, which are similar to the arguments that were presented and that you accepted in 172 Washington Street. One is whether or not you find there's particular circumstances relating to the soil, the shape, the topography, or structures, but don't generally affect zoning. That would be the case here. The condition of the structure, the historic structure, the size of the lot, and the building location on the lot, which all were factors in 172 Washington Street, are also factors here. This structure is historic, is obviously a historic structure on the historic inventory, and it is in a woeful condition of disrepair. The developer is seeking to demolish it, and he's already indicated that it would require far too much reconstruction, renovation, and demolition to make it worth his while to convert it to two-family, but he would be willing to preserve it as it is. So the fact that it's historic and the fact that it is in a condition of disrepair, which was the case in 172, is also the case here, which are particular circumstances relating to the structure. In addition, the parcel is of unusual size in the sense that it is larger than any other parcel in that area, also a factor in 172 Washington Street. The parcel in 172 Washington Street was, I believe, 21,000 square feet. This parcel is over 41,000 square feet, so it is extremely unusual for that or any other location in Reading, quite frankly. And finally, it's unusual for, as was the case in 172 Washington Street, it's unusual for a structure on such an oversized lot to be squeezed into the corner of that parcel, and in fact to be butted up against the front of Lowell Street as it is in this case. So all of those were factors which you found in 172 Washington Street justified your concluding that there were particular circumstances relating to the structure. They all apply in this case as well. Number two, literal enforcement would involve hardship, financial or otherwise, if a variance were not granted. That was the case in 172 Washington Street, and we would argue, as would Mr. Johnson, that that's the case here. If the owner would be required, as he's already said, to convert the existing home to two-family, it would not be worth its while economically. It would not be worth its while structurally, because that home is simply not conducive to an appropriate two-family reconstruction. Those were also factors, by the way, in 172 Washington Street. And lastly, it would result in significantly more demolition of this historic home than he would otherwise have to do if he could maintain it as single family and simply move it on this parcel of land, which he could do. Those are factors in 172 Washington, and they're also factors here. Third, desirable relief may be granted without substantial detriment to the public good. That was the case in 172 Washington, and we would submit it's also definitely the case here. In fact, granting this variance would enhance the existing historic house. It would correct its poor location on the nonconformity on the lot. It would provide for new and attractive two-family structures on this site. Two-family construction is consistent with the existing neighborhood. There is a group home in that area on the corner of Bancroft and Middlesex Ave effectively functions as a multifamily. And importantly, it is for the public good because it would support the purpose of the zoning bylaw to preserve a historic structure. And finally, the relief granted would not nullify or derogate the intent or purpose of the bylaw. That's the case here as it was in 172. The purpose of the bylaw, as I've already beaten to death, is to preserve historic structures. This would accomplish that. Zoning specifically allows for, as we're arguing in this case, the original two-family conversion of the original home, so it doesn't nullify or derogate the zoning bylaw. And lastly, the density that will be created by this, a new two-family home and the preserved historic structure, that density is no greater than, as Dave has already submitted, is already allowable on that 41,000 square foot property. He could convert, if he were willing, he could convert one home to two family and then put a new structure on the other one. So either way, he could, and that parcel could justify three families living on it. So it doesn't increase density. So for all of those reasons, we would argue, could we get past, and could he get past the first hurdle of the eight rooms, you could conceivably find your way to allowing a variance as you did at 172 Washington Street. Those were the arguments and those are the facts that we wanted to offer to you to weigh and to perhaps offer some guidance or direction. I know this isn't the public hearing on it, but I know Mr. Johnson is extremely interested in hearing what direction you might be leaning towards to dictate what he's going to do. I know we are extremely interested because the right outcome here could serve to preserve this extremely historic home for Reading. Thank you.
What district is it in?
Thank you.
What zoning is it?
S15.
Can you show me in the zoning bylaw where a two-family dwelling is allowed in S15 district?
It's in the table of uses. I think it's 5.53.
5.3.1.
Okay, where there's a footnote that says a single-family home existing prior to April 1942?
In a business A district.
I'm not aware that, that limitation exists. I thought it could, and I know it, you allowed it in the S-15 district at 172 Washington Street.
That was under the old zoning bylaw.
So you're suggesting, that's the first I'm hearing, with all due respect, and I've spoken to the town planner about this. She concurred that that footnote did not change anything from the prior, was not intended to change anything from the prior zoning bylaw, and just as before, that capacity was allowed in an S-15 district. It was her opinion as the town planner that it also applied under the new zoning bylaw.
I'm asking a question.
I appreciate that, and it's a good question. I have not heard that, and I'm surprised if that were the case that I didn't hear that from her.
I will plead guilty to having been more involved in that area of the zoning bylaw rewrite than I wanted to be. But if you look specifically at the table, page 31 of the revised zoning bylaw, is a two-fam, so you have, well, let me just double. Okay. I misread it. In a residential district, it is allowed. In a business district, it's only allowed in business A. So the town planner is correct. I misspoke a minute ago. So we're in an S-15 district.
Yes, and I'm glad to hear that. Thank you.
Okay.
No problem.
I wanted to make sure I'm
and it only would be allowed if, correct me if I'm wrong, if in fact it were an 8-room structure prior to 1942.
Finished.
And that's where the burden of proof seems.
Yeah, there's no question. It has to be a single family usage, yeah, which there was no question about, and it has to have existed prior to 1942. All of those elements exist other than,
yeah,
this one knotty issue relative to the 8 rooms, yes. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
I would be personally, if this came to us, and again, we're kind of, I think everybody here supports, and I don't want to speak for it, but I think everybody on the board would support the retention of historical structures in town, if at all possible, and if it allows us in the bylaws to do it, and I think that's what we have to hang our hat on.
Agreed.
I would be certainly interested in seeing this 1946 plan. You say, now, who did the plan? Was it a surveyor? Was it a legal surveyor that did this plan?
It was.
I don't know in 1942 if they used stamps then. But, it was a legal surveyor. And I would put a lot of precedent onto that in 1946 that L was not on there, or that addition was not there.
We do have it here.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. I'm just, when we get a packet, and that's what I know you.
Yeah.
It was done by Dana Perkins.
Okay.
It was signed by the running. You guys had a board of survey back then, and I registered at the obviously Cambridge in 1946.
Oh, okay, right here. And yeah, see, and then the particular one today. I gotta get myself lined up here. I think this is it right here. That's it, and does not have the additions.
It's that L that does not exist in that plot plan. No question.
You see it, sir? Pass along. You don't want to see that, John. There's the structure there in 1946, and there's the structure today.
Maybe that's the way it is. Well, to me, the question that I have for the board, your board, is what is it that you want from us?
Well, what we want is to preserve the house. The developer has remarkably, and as I said, graciously and generously, agreed to do that in certain circumstances. He wants to be permitted to construct a new two-family house. So ultimately, based on the arguments that and the facts that we presented, what he and we would need is ultimately We want direction now, but ultimately, positive feedback concerning the direction the ZBA would follow if it had before it, the question about, in the face of ambiguous information about whether the eight rooms exist in this context, would you be inclined, in an effort to preserve the house, to find that it meets the requirement and it may convert lawfully to two families? And then on the basis of that, and based on the arguments that I presented, but didn't necessarily argue in the case, but will be argued in the case, a variance would be warranted for this application to build a new two-family apartment and preserve the single family, rather, based on the right of the single family historic home to convert to two-family,
right,
but utilize that in the new or in the new two-family building. That's what we're looking for, positive guidance from you on that. And I don't mean to suggest that that's the outcome you need to find, but the developer is seeking that, because if it doesn't look like that's the direction that the ZBA could likely go, then he is not likely going to be going in that direction and will fall back on his original plan of, I assume, of demolishing the historic home and putting up two new homes on that site.
What you're asking for is, I believe, a direction. I think this board has always been open to anything that comes before, consider the factual material that's presented to it, and then look for what is best in the offing for the town of Reading. And certainly in the bylaws, preservation of historical buildings has been indoctrinated into the bylaws, not only this one, but at least three previous, I won't call them recodifications, but updates. So the question to me is that you've got several hurdles to get over. The idea of just getting an A&R and splitting the lot, that's a planning board, and then looking at two, even if you prove the one, can you get a second two-family in a single residential area to go up? That's a planning board issue also that has to come back to this board. But I mean, you're talking about a fair amount of time to go through this process, and we don't even know what other issues that are going to be presented by the other town agency. So my recommendation is to go before redevelopment board?
CPDC.
No. It's an initials. It's represented from each of the engineering.
DRT
board.
DRT board.
I would suggest going to the DRT and seeing if this is something that's going to be able to be gotten off the ground, if you could do the following. I mean, if you're going to go that route, you might as well get everything out in the open to begin with and find out what each individual's concerns are, because the developer I'm looking at is looking at a time factor also. If you can't do it within a reasonable amount of time, there goes all your options. You have to move forward. You have to do something. So what's the time frame that you're looking at? I don't think this board is going to come out and say that, you know,
no,
we're in total support.
Say,
we
yeah,
can't
we'll
do that.
It's
not a hearing.
No.
Not
we don't know, because we don't have a package. We can't say, yeah, we would have supported or we won't support it, because we don't know what it's going to be, really.
Right.
And certainly, it would be my inclination to take all the information that's been presented to us under advisement and into consideration and give it a little bit of thought before rendering any type of, I mean, you're asking us for advice, because that's all that we can offer you at this stage.
Yeah.
We need to be very careful about what advice we offer.
Yes.
A variance is a statutory animal, and you've asked us to consider proposed alternatives, which are not allowed under a consideration of a variance, whether or not the applicant meets the four criteria or not. So we have to be understanding that there are somewhat competing interests. While everybody ultimately wants to do the right thing, there are some competing interests that I think I would want to take into consideration before I offered any advice. And certainly would be something we'd want to discuss. But again, we have to be careful about doing that too, because this is not a public hearing, and are we doing deliberations, and we need to be mindful of the open meeting law, and the proposed applicant has rights too.
May I ask one question, Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you very much. I know I appreciate it. I'm sure Dave appreciates it. We as the board appreciate it. If I can be direct about this, and theoretically, I guess the first question, the question about the variance and the four factors, I agree. That's and I think we all agree. Although I think those arguments are there, I want to ask the board's opinion concerning the preliminary question or a preliminary question. This question of eligibility of a home to convert under that 5.32 to convert to two family. The question to ponder is on the issue of whether or not it had 8 rooms as of April of 1942, where a case does not conclusively prove that it did or that it didn't, since the ZBA would have to make a determination whether in this particular case or a particular case it did, could the ZBA find its way to concluding that a house did have the requisite 8 rooms in the face of conflicting information, one perhaps a plot plan showing that it wasn't there, which is fairly convincing, but for the fact of another piece of information, which is 4 or 5 permits were applied for after 1942, none of them for an L, which would lead someone to argue that must mean that the L was there beforehand. That's my question that I'm looking for direction from. Could the ZBA, absent hard, conclusive confirmation fact that it did or didn't, could it weigh those two things and, depending on the case, conclude that in that case it met that standard, or could it not, absent the conclusive proof? I don't know if you can answer that, but that's the real key question.
I think it boils down to a lot of it is personal opinion, a personal thoughts in regards to is the proof there or is it not there?
It's weighing each member of the board's weighing the credibility of each piece of information.
And we also look to
the board
building inspector too for his advice, and we turned to him many times. He is for records.
Yeah.
We look to him in regards to that. As I said tonight, looking at this and what you presented and stuff, I put a lot of credence into that 1946 plot plan that did not show an addition on it. That's personal, that I do anyway.
Yeah, my observation would be a similar thing. And I think you made the comment that the assessor cards or records showed that stated it had 8 rooms?
Yes, in 1950.
Can you link a date to that?
1956 is a copy of the card there.
Again,
that's as early as we can get.
Yeah, but they don't have the assessor's cards, they said.
I kind of share Bob's comment, and that is that plot plan is very damning. It says it wasn't there.
Yeah. And the building permits get lost, misplaced, whatever. There could have been a building permit pulled for that in 1948, and gets misplaced, gets lost, whatever.
On the other hand,
we don't know. On the other hand,
that was prior to any zoning being in place.
Right, that's right.
Yeah, and then so it was not done like a plot plan we see today either. It's much cruder. So
There's no chair back there, I'd like to make a comment.
I know we've also had cases, and I think, where people have brought evidence in regards to census, in regards to different families living at a particular address. Okay, this is address such and such, and then, you know, 1917 or 1923 or something, they did a census, and according to this, there were two different families or three different families living at this address, and, you know, different names, different last names.
We do have that. In 1942, there were two families with four people there with two different last names, which could possibly be two families.
And again, this is all gathered when we make a decision, and it taken again. But I think in this particular case, it's a lot of this is going to hinge on that eighth room.
It all hinges on that eighth room.
Yeah, and the proving of that. And then from there, it's like, where do we go from there then?
Yeah.
Then it's what you're asking is, well, okay, we have this historical house as eight rooms, and we're eligible to convert that to a two-family. But we don't want to. We want to take that right and build a new two-family and take that historical house, and that, and correct me if I'm wrong, that's going to remain a single family.
That's correct.
Okay. And I want to build a two-family on a lot that I'm carving out of the original lot. It's very, very convoluted.
For which a variance would obviously be required.
Yeah.
Well, if you can make the argument that the rights afforded to the owner of the historical building can be transferred to the separate lot.
Yeah. It's the same owner. I guess you could argue it would be the same owner at that particular time. I think you kind of get a flavor of where the board sits on this.
And we're grateful. Thank you.
It may make sense to pose a couple of these same questions to town council. You know, that's who we defer to when we have sticky situations. Ray Miaris is, a learned, experienced municipal attorney who's probably forgotten more about the questions that you're asking than we'll ever know. It might be a good resource for you as well if you haven't already tapped into him.
I haven't spoken to him about this one, but I have found that he hasn't forgotten much.
Dumb observation, okay? If you were to say, okay, I'm going to build a new two-family and leave the historical building and make that a one-family, does that or not, does it negate the issue of the eighth room?
No, because first of all, he's creating two lots, a new lot out of there.
Right.
And they're not allowed, correct me, in an S-15
that's right.
zone to construct a two-family.
Well, I understand.
So
he can't get to the two-family unless he can get to that eighth room.
That's another subject.
So I would say no, in that particular case.
I'm not sure where I come down on it.
I'm just
hearing it for the first time, and I'd want
to want to do a two-family and leave that one as a single-family raises a lot of other
issues.
Does that negate the issue of an eight-room house?
I don't know. I don't know if you can transfer that right to the application to build a new structure.
It would. I'll talk to Mr. Johnson, but you don't feel it would be conducive to convert the historical structure to a two-family?
No.
You couldn't do that.
Well, you could try, but it'd be prohibitive.
Really?
Yeah.
Now, let me ask this question too. You're going to create two new lots. What the thoughts are? You're going to move. Is everything going to conform to zoning bylaws in regards to offsets
of
these structures? So you're planning on moving that structure then, the historical structure, moving it back?
I was going to have to move it off the foundation, take that foundation out, then move it back, but it would have been without the garage.
Okay, yeah, I,
so to make
that,
it,
that's something you would deal with,
yeah,
historically.
Right.
That's what I'm saying. What if, in fact, it ended up that you did, were allowed to do this or whatever, I would suspect you're not going to remove that whole thing with it, the additions that maybe were constructed, the garage, et cetera, et cetera. It's,
correct.
Yeah,
the
more of a
main house in any scenario would have.
But that your plan is, you would actually move the historical structure,
yep,
back, whatever requirement you'd need to get your frontage.
Those go, just.
Yeah, to get your frontage and side setbacks, you would have to move that.
Yep.
Okay. Well, certainly that, you know, that's what the board looks for, that, okay, great, you're doing this, we don't have to give you any variance in regards to lot size, frontage, side setbacks, frontage, or anything like that. I think
you pose a very unique question for a community such as Reading. And if you have the manpower, or if your board has the manpower, not talking to you right now, Mr. Johnson, I'd try to divide myself into two parts. One is to go out and find somebody who could maybe even look at the construction that was done in this L, and to go back and talk to the building inspector and see if the two of them can come to an agreement. Option two would be, the other half of the team would be looking at, I'm going to suggest again, the DRT, to look at possible problems down the road, because this is going to come up again. And if you got people in the town who are looking to do this type of thing, it is certainly out of the box. And if you can get it out of the box and under consideration, if you're looking for changes in the bylaws down the road someplace, it certainly can help out in the future. So,
Glenn is, as I mentioned to the RHC folks, Glenn has looked at it. He's looked underneath it. He's, in his opinion, based on the building materials, he would, I just know he's not, no way he's going anywhere near 1942.
Right.
And so therefore he, you know, he was very good about it. Said, you know, you can prove it with, and I said to Jonathan, Virginia and Company, you know, we need, you know, documentation would be good.
We agree.
Documentation, because, you know, Glenn, based on building materials, as you've just suggested, Glenn has done that and checked it out.
And that's what we'd be looking to Glenn for his advice. I mean, I haven't been in it. You say Glenn has, he looked at it.
Yes.
I'm not saying what he found, but if he walked in and there were wall board there, and there were the 2x4s were actually 3.5 by 1.5, and not the rough cut 2x4s, I would say, this all points to recent construction.
Right.
You know, I would suspect anything in the 20s or 30s, you're going to see rough cut lumber behind the walls, the studs and the rafters, everything would
it
be
depends.
Rough cut.
It depends on what end that you want to go to.
Yeah,
and
how far
certainly
do you
want to
go?
There's two damning facts right now against the 8 rooms. One is the plot plan of 46, and the other one would be the construction materials in the L, in the addition. So unless you could perhaps dissuade some of that because of other documents or whatever you found, I mean, it's very possible that portions of that house could have been updated for particular reasons at different times. A sick member of the family who needed more advanced help in the 50s, and they changed that one room around to meet those needs. I don't know. I mean, that's why I say you have to go out there and do the digging. But right now, you have to present that to a number of different people. So certainly, whatever you can do, you have to get over the immediate two hurdles if you can't be back before this board for that particular reason. But I mean, I don't think you can, as so many of the other board members have mentioned, you know, this is not a board decision. It is individuals' decision coming together when the final vote is taken by the board, and to try to figure out what that's going to be is impossible until you actually have facts in front of you, because each person's mind can be changed as you go through the process.
Yeah, this is very helpful.
Have you had any of these other conversations with other relevant boards or committees?
Yes. We've talked with the town planner, with Jesse Wilson. We've had several meetings, and then the site visit with the building inspector. And plus, the commission had a site visit with a consultant on early architecture, and he went through there, too. So we've been trying to get a lot of work done.
Yeah.
To get to this point, because it's only a 6 month demolition delay,
mm-hmm.
and we have to work within that time frame, so it makes it difficult. But I'm not sure DRT is going to get us in any more direction, because I'm thinking that that's primary police and fire, and we sit in on DRTs on old houses.
But it doesn't have to be a complete DRT. Specific portions of the DRT would be.
Which would include ZBA, the building inspector, and
well, the limited site plan review type, like a limited site plan review.
Yes, very similar to limited
type of.
I think we've done
gathering.
That, but not all together.
Right.
So.
Right.
Yeah, I mean, it's a wonderful idea if we had the luxury of the time to for all of us to invest the town into coming up with another alternative, you know, whether it's a bylaw change or what have you. But we don't have that time.
Not on this project, you don't.
Yeah, well,
in the future,
when this project ends, that house is either
right.
going to be gone or
moved.
Going to be gone or moved, right. So, and as far as we can tell, other than the process you've rightly suggested of a DRT and getting the town invested in coming up with a whole new alternative, the only existing alternative right now, which would enable or empower the developer to provide a two-family home, would be through this mechanism of, you know, getting that qualification of the historic home to convert to two-family, and then coming before the ZBA for a variance like 172 Washington. So that's the only option that we could see, unless we could convince the developer to convert the historic home to two-family, which I don't think is going to be successful.
The board comes up with a solution that we haven't thought of yet. Mm-hmm.
Well, David, I think, brought another issue up that has to be addressed, too, and that is, can you transfer that right from the existing, if you prove the eighth room, two-unit to a new two-unit? Is that a transferable item?
Well, is that not, if maybe I don't understand it, but is that not what was done with respect to 172 Washington Street?
It was all done on the same lot, Jonathan.
So it's the competition of an additional
case,
new lot.
It would be transferring to a different
lot.
A separate lot.
Yeah, okay.
Where it otherwise would not be allowed.
Yeah.
Yeah, understood.
Right. Where this other lot couldn't do it anyway. So I think we would be looking in that particular case, maybe going to town council
right.
and getting advice.
Yeah, that would certainly be an issue with the board.
Searching, yes.
Yeah.
Would need some advice on.
Okay.
Anything else that we can go ahead? Sure.
You were mentioning that some of the zoning hadn't occurred before 1942 in the same way, and I wondered whether, since this was a historic house and it does date back previously to the 1700s, where families took in the other families, or, you know, as it served as we have documentation for having two families probably that lived there together, but we didn't have the requirements during the 1700s and 1800s of zoning like we do now that would say you need four rooms. Does any of that come into play in the way in which you evaluate? I mean, it's not as though it's a 1900 house with seven rooms that they're trying to have be possibly the eight rooms. It could have still functioned as a two-family. But considering the fact that it was 1700, 1800, 1900, just.
I would suggest that we would take all of that into consideration. You know, how much weight we would give to it would be sort of
but
member.
But in that particular case, I don't think the argument so far, or at least presented by the developer, by the historical commission, has noted that they are looking to say they want to continue a two-family.
I'm
the
just
argument
about the
has been
the rights,
this
right.
is a this was a single family home head, but the argument is we're we legally can convert it to a two-family if there were eight rooms.
Mm-hmm.
That's what we're trying to prove, is the eight-room thing. And it's got nothing to do with, well, it's been a two-family home for 100 years or something.
No. And I guess that's the point I was looking for. You're looking for current zoning and just that box. Okay, thank you.
Well, the bylaw is very specific about that particular issue. A two-family would be eight rooms existing prior to zoning, which is 42, April 42.
I understand. I'm a historian, so I have a very long view. Nothing's ever in a box, so thank you. I appreciate the clarification.
Well, the only other thing is that that's during the time of the Second World War, and if things were done quickly by the town mm-hmm. prior to that, you might be able to go back and research some records or whatever and get something like that done. I mean, a lot of things were done during the war period that maybe not didn't get on the town's mm-hmm. agenda.
Right.
So.
Points well taken, and food for thought.
Would we be able to retrieve that plot plan?
I give it back. Yeah.
Oh.
We were wishing we hadn't found it.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank
you.
Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you. Yeah. Right.
Okay. So
motion to adjourn.
Is a board reorganization. We typically, as John says, do that the first meeting in July, June 30th, ends the fiscal year with the town and go to the boards. We haven't had a meeting since then. So consequently, I think we maybe just to go on record, we should maybe discuss reorganization. All we do is a chair and a vice chair coming 2015-2016.
Right, and it's the practice for each chair and vice chair to serve in 2 year
two-year maximum periods.
And this would be second year for each of us.
Yeah, I believe it will be, yes. I had that wrong. I mentioned that to Maureen, and I told her, I said, I would have to go back and look, but I believe this was the second year for me on this term, in this particular run anyway. And consequently, it would be for you too, David. I have no problems maintaining the way the board structure is now. But that's up to board members, and I think we should probably put it to a vote on this.
Well, I would move to retain you as the chair, and as the vice chair for the coming year.
We have a motion. We have a second. Any further discussion? All those in favor?
Yeah. Quick and easy.
Done.
Easy.
Now, noting next year we will be having a reorganization. Okay, glad to do it.
As am I.
Yes. And okay, motion to adjourn.
Second.
And all those in favor? Okay, thank you. Thank you so much, everybody. And we do have a meeting coming up September 3rd. We have one item on the agenda right now.